And, ladies and gentlemen, I had the Kaufman's plant in Bennettsville, South Carolina, where I was with this gray trailer in March, I think, 2015, when I came back from California to get it fixed. And so now it's in. This is over there, you see all new trailers. So my truck is in the bay. So they're replacing the... I don't like this thing lying around. So they're replacing the Honda. Actually, I asked the guys to check my hydraulic oil level and also told them about the ride height, how it changed when I replaced the ride height valve on my trailer. And the mag dealer installed it and the ride height was wrong. I think my mag dealer has a problem with the, you know, the ride height for some reason. If you saw my previous vid where I was sweating and complaining a lot, they did the same on the truck recently, right? So I had to reset it. So now the Kaufman guys here, they reset my ride height back to the factory. And I asked them, I said, what's the trick? Oh, wow, look. Some of these you can get with ramps like this. I love the look of these, you know, new shiny trailers. Wow. That's what I'm talking about, you know? This would be really cool for... I still see they're welding the D-rings at the top. Actually, wait a second. That's how it should be. Uh-huh, so they did change the design. And I see that they increased the distance. So now they put in less cross members. Uh-huh. You see? You saw my old videos where I was complaining about this, because when you raise it, right, on my trailer, this thing was not going over the top. It's like basically over here because it was welded in the middle on my trailer. It's in the middle. So I always have to put some corners in here, and that kills paint, you know? And most trailers on the market, they always put the D-rings at the top, because this way you just put your chain in. It's not touching your trailer, it's not damaging anything, nothing is, because this is very sharp, you know? So this is great, so great news. And I remember last time I was talking to the engineer, he said they were thinking about this, because that's actually the standard, like, industry standard, that distance. But on my trailer, they're closer, because they wanted to make it stronger. But because of that, when they put the cross members closer, that's the cross member, right? When they put the cross members closer, they don't have room in here, because this thing will be in here, and that's why they put them lower. So, you know, so my trailer, at least, so like there's pluses and minuses, right? So my trailer is stronger, but because of that, it also weighs more. So these should be lighter, and the D-rings at the top. So that's good. And of course, this is not good for heavy machinery. Like if you're hauling, this is what they call a, what they call it, like a construction trailer. You know those guys that pave roads, they put the machines in here. Because if you try to haul an excavator on this, this will be in the way of the boom. So the boom will sit very tall. So, so this is, you know, basically a specialized trailer. Okay, so I see this. That's what they changed. And you can get these in pretty much any capacity, you know, like 35 ton. Well, they don't have 40 or 45. It's 35, 50, 55. And I got 55, even though I don't even haul over... I never even haul 90,000 pounds, which is 45 tons, right? But I wanted to have an extra cushion, like to be a trailer a bit stronger, because you don't want to max out the capacity, right? So I wanted... Yeah, by the way, they're not paying me for this. I'm just... This is not a sponsored video. This is a real video. I just like the product, you know? It does have its limitations, but it's cheap and it works. And it's pretty good quality, you know? So yeah, that's kind of like... Yeah, you see? They changed the D-ring design. That's like a real major thing, like at least for me, because I have to deal with this every time. But you see on this trailer, they didn't cover this part, right, yet. Oh, and I have a pocket in here, right? Like over here on my trailer, that's an option actually. You can choose. They use shorter, like lower frame members, and that way they put the little bucket pocket in here. So it comes very handy. I love that feature. I wouldn't buy a trailer without it, because this helps to make the excavator lower, because you don't want at the top of the boom, you know, get into trouble with bridges. But one other thing that I just learned, they told me one other thing they changed is they changed the height, you know, the height of the deck. So this is kind of like my trailer, right? 55 ton, I think, with the ramps, pretty much the same as mine, except that, yeah, the cross members are spaced a bit farther apart, just like normal, and the D-rings are at the top. But this is the new trailer. If you can see this, you see the difference? Now look at the front on this one, the height under the ramp. And look at the height on this one under the ramp. See? That's what's different. Like over here it's like this. And over here it's like this. I think this trailer, this new design, they did like new kind of like whatever it's called, capering. The see? Taller, lower. So this will be good news to heavy haulers like me, because even 1 inch counts. Yeah, that's what I was talking about. That's what I have on my trailer, right? I love this thing. Oh, and that's another thing they added, is this. My trailer does not have it. So this prevents, if you have something here like lying around, you know, prevents it from sliding off. Like if you have a board or something, just as a precaution. Of course, you have to secure it, but look how thick these are. Oh, and I think they changed this as well. Because yeah, it doesn't look like this part in here where it connects. It's different. I think maybe my trailer is actually stronger, because on my trailer there's like another plate. Actually, wait a second. There is a plate. Hold on. Yeah, there is a plate in here. See this plate in here? But it's pretty small. Maybe it's a 50 ton, I don't know, but on my trailer, this plate over here, it's massive, and it covers the entire width here. It just covers this corner, which I'm pretty, and this is great. These add 800 pounds to the weight of the trailer, which is not good, but you need them, you know. These load-bearing fenders, because you can put a small bobcat in here, you know, you go on vacation and you find a load, let's say you want to go to Florida for the winter, if you are from Canada, and you find a load going to Florida, you put your little Mazda in here, and when you drive there, and then you shut down and use your Mazda to zoom around, you know, beautiful. And you see this one is reinforced just like mine for the fourth axle. And so they do this, and they reinforce the back so that the trailer can take fourth axle. And so I was thinking about this, like I have it, right? My trailer is all what they call prepped for the fourth axle. But the truth is that the fourth axle, because of the bridge formula in the United States, it's too far from the truck and from the load, so you don't get a lot of credit when you get a permit. Let's say you're hauling oversized, nobody's gonna give you 20,000 pounds for that axle, even though it's gonna be like all these axles are 25,000 pounds in capacity, you know. So nobody over here, most states only give you 60, right? But that axle, you'll get, you if you get, I don't know, 10,000 pounds, you're lucky, you know. But it costs over $10,000. So I'm not sure. But I see, actually, the thing is, in Canada, I see lots of guys using them, by the way. I see guys with the fourth axle, so probably at least in Canada they work. I don't know. Maybe I'll get it later. At least the good news is that my trailer is set up for it, you know? Boy, it's hot. But I feel like a kid, you know, a kid at Christmas. Like, you know, you send a kid into a toy store. That's what I feel like. I don't know. I used to look like, when I was dealing with real estate, you know, I used to like just looking at houses and buildings and just, because to me, real estate was kind of cool, but then I got bored. So now I'm into machinery. Machinery, equipment. I love all these excavators and the trailers, these heavy haul trailers. Love it. By the way, here's another new thing, right, that probably you can get. Actually, I know it's available as an option. I even saw it on my, when I was specing my trailer. Actually, this would be pretty cool, you know? Because even now with my fancy fenders, I see lots of stuff flying this way, you know? And causing corrosion. And I talked to the guy about this. Because they said they're working on this, they're gonna come up with some solution. Because this thing, of course, it opens this way. So as you're driving and the truck is shaking, this thing, this arm, is going down. And, you know, I have fenders in here, right? Again, those overpriced plastic fenders. And this thing, when I turn, this thing starts catching on fenders. So I asked the guys what would be a good way, and I said I was thinking of putting like a steel plate in here. Just put a plate that sits in here and goes under, you know, and then just lower it a little bit to put tension on it. But then it might come out, you know. If it comes out at the highway speed, it's not very safe. And I said, oh, maybe I should just put a strap in here, you know, just put a strap and go to the other side, make it short, you know. Of course, you have to undo it each time, but then you don't have to restart the Honda each morning, you know. That's what I have to deal with now, unless I want to get my fenders ripped. And I said, I wasn't sure about the weight, like, what's the weight of this thing? Like, how big of a strap do you need? Because it looks like, I don't know, it can be like 200 kilos, you know, 400 pounds. I don't know, how much pressure does it put in? And the guy over there said, no, he says, all you need is maybe like 1-inch strap. He says, it's not that much. Just a little bit so it doesn't come loose. And that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to just put a strap with some flat, you know, flat hooks. Like this. Go under. So one problem solved, but I'm really glad that, you know, Kaufman is improving their trailers. Like, this is great. You know, the way I found out about this, because I was mentioning to the guy who was helping me to back in and he was adjusting the ride height, I said, sometimes I wish I had a drop rail design, you know, where the sides are lower, but then, of course, you might have trouble with crates and boxes. Any load that has a flat floor, flat bottom, you have to use blocking, you know, and not every shipper will agree to that. And the guy said, oh, but our new trailer is lower. I said, really? Can I see? And he shows me this. So I was really happy to see this. This, I don't know if it's, I mean, this one. Oh, by the way, here. Here's the old one. I think it's an option, right? So you can probably get, that's what I have. You see the height and this one. So now it sits on the ground and you already can see the difference. So imagine, and you see it's more curved than this one. So once you hook up a truck to it, it's gonna be lower, definitely. At least, I don't know, a couple of inches. And also see the ramps here have holes in them. Huh, that's probably some kind of a lightweight option. They're much lighter. But I don't know how they would withstand all these excavators, you know? And I told them about that hack I did where I went to a trailer shop and they welded a plate in here, because this part takes a lot of beating with an excavator if it dozer or an excavator, anything on tracks, just goes off a little bit. If the guy falls asleep at the wheel, or you know, where, like if you remember, there was a Dale excavator where the guy was unloading a pretty heavy, like 82,000 pound excavator. He got distracted, he went a little bit to the side, he bent that one, and he ripped off one of these bars. Well, almost ripped off, right? And then somebody suggested I weld a plate in here. So I welded a plate in here and here and on the other side, and this part became much stronger. And I showed this to them, so I said, maybe you guys should do this, you know, because that's a really, really weak part. So anyway, so that was a quick tour around Kaufman. It's a relatively big facility. I see there's trailers waiting to be painted over there. So new ones are behind me. There's some ones over here. And some over there. I guess that's where you can get them loaded if you want to stack them on a trailer. Oh yeah, and they also make these ones for lumber. So if you want to do some lumber hauling, they can build this one too. I think this is an old one. Probably came in as a Evans. Okay, came in as a replacement, but this is a new one. Wow, look at that board in here. That's what I call a headache rack. Okay. So that's Kaufman trailers for you, ladies and gentlemen. And so I'm getting a new Honda. And by the way, I checked under. On these all new engine, on the, I was able to see under, the Honda itself is mounted on a separate plate. There's a little, like a curved little foundation. It's not mounted directly to the frame of the trailer. It's mounted onto that plate, and they do use bushings, but I don't know. I guess they're not strong enough. So they didn't change the design of that one. Say hello to my little friend. This is my new Honda GX390 UT2. And you see how it's mounted? It has its own separate plate. And that's where it cracked, right? So these are the bushings, and they gave me some extra ones. And they seem pretty good, you know? So one bushing under each bolt, and then there's a washer. So they say they never had it cracked like this, like it did on my trailer. I'll have to add gas. But this thing definitely needs protection in winter, you know, in bad weather, because the water flies in here and everything gets corroded. Alright, let me shut it down. I've accomplished a lot of things today, so new Honda that's to replace the broken cable that holds this casing in position. And I asked them to give me something stronger. They said, we can give you a dual one, double. So instead of one cable, they use it two, just twisted them, you know, like a rope. So I hope now it'll last longer, right? So they also checked the oil. They said over here it should be in the middle, like 6 inches from the bottom. Otherwise it'll be splashing from the top. And now I know what to do with this one. I'll just get a small strap and tie it down. And they checked everything, and also they adjusted the right height. That's this little lever over here, and they gave me a spare one. So now I have this lever, I have a spare one. That's the long one, and you adjust it. He says the distance from the axle to this part of the frame should be 6 inches. Okay. And by the way, one more thing. Now they changed. I forgot to mention. I only saw it at the last moment. But you see how on my trail all the controls, like this is my. What is this? This is override for my manual thing. Manual right height, right? These are my flashing lights. And this is my axle. So I guess they were getting complaints from people. And in my case also, I had to replace this one a couple of times, the switch. Then that one got corroded. This one stopped working, I think, once. So now on new trailers, what they do is they use this spot in here. You know, right in front of the tire, see there's little kind of like a niche here, and it's protected by steel, and that's where the controls sit now. You know, cool. I don't know how they get in there, but somehow, yeah, oh, okay, it's open. Over here it's open, but... So you want to flip your axle, you know, you don't have to go all the way like this. You just come in here, boom, done. Oh, and also on new trailers, one more thing. Now it's an option, they can cover this from the factory. They can cover this hole, because I told them that I'm often bugged by shippers that they don't like this, you know, open middle, especially in winter in Canada. You know, when they ship, let's say, I don't know, like $500,000 worth piece of equipment, like some kind of factory machine, like not an excavator, but machine, and it sits here, and they want me to top the bottom, you know? Or I put some boards in, but actually I need these boards to create a level surface, right? And so then I have nothing here. So either for me, I can just get some either plywood or maybe just a piece of steel like this. For the winter I wanna do something. And it's hot as hell. That's it, I give up, so I have the clean idle mode active. And for those people that like to panic, line 2 says no action required. So don't panic. And by the way, above that, in Celsius, 41 Celsius. Okay, let me do a quick conversion. If 35 was 200 Fahrenheit, that's my table of conversion. Then 41, I think it's about 250 F.